Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 45 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am once again Temitayo Osinubi, your number one resource to teach you the reality of digital marketing to propel your career. So this is going to be one of my solo casts, no guests this week, and I'm just going to give you some information that I think should be on your radar, recounts for my experiences in the last month. And since our last solo cast, I had the opportunity to participate in my very first hackathon with Goodie Nation, hashtag HackTheViolence College Innovation Lab. And so hashtag HackTheViolence is a year-long process to develop startups to reduce violence by 40% by the year 2020. Very big initiative. And this was my very first hackathon. So for those who don't know, a hackathon is basically when you get someone who just more or less has an idea or a concept, but doesn't have a lot of infrastructure yet. And you get together some marketers, some UX people, some design people, some web developers, some coders, and you literally do a hackathon, like a marathon, all day, all night. And in 32 hours, you bust out a clickable prototype of an app, website, landing page, revenue model, pitch, the whole nine. And that's what we did at Pivotal Labs at the Pont City Market in Atlanta, Georgia with Goodie Nation. And it was a very, very good experience. Shout out to Joey Womack of Goodie Nation and Amplify for Good for putting the whole thing together. And the hackathon was actually the second stage of Joey's college incubator. So these were college teams who came together for the purpose of reducing violence. And myself, along with other members of the professional community, we came and we volunteered our time to these young people who otherwise would not have been able to afford our services. So it was our way of giving back. There was food provided. It was a very good experience, and we all got to see and hear some very interesting pitches. So I must say that the future is bright as we march ever closer towards SkyNet. Okay, because I will be honest, man, there was a lot of inspiring things at the pinch competition, but there was also some pretty scary stuff as well. I mean, the so just to back up, the top grand prize was $120,000 in cloud computing services from Microsoft. And then you had the team prizes. The first team prize was $1,000 cash. The second team prize was $500 cash, and the third team prize was $250 cash. And I was on the team that went third, and the team that won it all, that took the $120,000 in cloud computing services from Microsoft, was from a startup called Go Safely, which is designed to help reduce rape on college campuses. And it's a step up from the blue light system. And this is a device that you actually wear on your person that will alert campus authorities, and they've already prototyped it. They use it making 3D printers. Really, really cool stuff. And another team there, which kind of put me on edge a little bit, was called Cyber Us, and it was designed to help reduce violence against the LGBTQ community. And so they were an app that was going to use predictive analytics and AI to identify individuals who might be likely to commit crimes against the lesbian gay community and alert authorities pretty much stop the crime before it happens. And that one did not sit well with me, because it's more or less like they looked at the movie Minority Report or looked at a couple episodes of the television show and was like, yeah, let's do that. I think we can make that in real life. And the reason that that one kind of scared me a little bit was because, as you all well know, deadly encounters with the police is seemingly on the rise. I don't know if this actually become more common or if it just appears more common because we all have video recorders in our pockets now, but when you want to talk about something like sarcasm, that's difficult even for a human being to decipher most times, right? Because let's be frank, some people have a very sarcastic and frankly inappropriate sense of humor, but at the end of the day, it's just jokes, right? It's not meant to be serious and no one's actually in danger. So now you're talking about using predictive analytics and artificial intelligence to try and sift out who's really a threat and who's not. And I think that that could potentially increase the number of deadly police encounters, which is a problem. And that is one of the things that, you know, it kind of gave me the shivers a little bit. But on the whole, it was just a very inspiring process. I was honored to participate along with our teams. We were there from 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. And I was actually there from 9 to 9 on Saturday. And then Sunday, we turned back around, got there at 9 o'clock, and we were pitching by that afternoon. And so the team that I was on that took third place with the $250 prize was called Civility. And Civility was geared toward reporting your actual interactions with police, because a lot of the police apps that already exist, like the ACLU app and the Stop and Frisk app and some other ones, they let you report incidences of excessive force to the police department, but it's not set up to actually let you rate the officer individually. So Civility is more like a rate your professor or a Glassdoor for individual police officers. And so if there is an instance of excessive force, you are able to report it immediately. And it uses blockchain technology, so you don't have to worry about it being altered or changed. You can file a report right there in the app, because there is an element of intimidation when you want to talk about reporting excessive force, because, you know, if you're being bullied, you're not really going to go to the bully or their crew and say, hey, I have a problem with you guys. So this allows people to report it without having to actually go into the police precinct. And it goes to a liaison in the police department who handles the reports. And there are mechanisms that prevent people from downgrading cops that they haven't actually interacted with in gaming the system. And it, like I said, it came in third place, and there was a lot of positives in this app, because there's an educational aspect to it as well. So on the landing page, which is something that I helped come up with, you're going to have a series of videos that you can actually sign up for. That's going to get people into the funnel. That's going to get them an autoresponder. Once you're in the app, you can register for ongoing education, and then municipalities can also use it as a recruiting tool, right? Because one of the problems that municipalities have is that they don't have enough minorities willing to be police officers. Community relations has been on an all-time low because, of course, you have cops on national television shooting people unarmed. That does not bode well for morale and other things. So with the ability to actually rate police interactions, both positive and negative, so it's not all bad. If you have positive interactions with a police officer, you can notate that as well, and they can have good ratings. So you can say, hey, we need more officers like this. Or if an individual officer has a record of excessive cases, you can actually petition the mayor and say, hey, we got to get this guy off the street because he's a menace. It's only a matter of time before he kills somebody. It's a miracle he hasn't killed anybody yet. And so I was just really, really proud and inspired to be a part of that team and work on that app. I sincerely hope that the app actually sees the light of day and continues the process, because this was just the first process, right? Because like I said, the founders more or less just showed up with an idea, and then members of the community came together in the hackathon, and we hacked it on out and produced a prototype, landing page, clickable app, the whole nine, revenue model. And so shout out to Jeremy and Donovan, the two guys who came up with that from Roverlent. And I really hope it sees the light of day. So we're going to take a short break, and then when I get back, I'm going to dive deeper. So stick with me.
We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave, and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it. Hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon.
And we're back. So one of the things that was most inspiring and encouraging to me about Goodie Nation's Hack the Violence Hackathon was just how very diverse the college team of students were. So you had every ethnicity and gender represented. It was a very good mix of male and female. You had Black, white, Asian, Indian. Everybody was in the place, right? There was no group of people that you can say was left out. And staying in the same vein of tech for good, a few weeks later, you had your very first innovation congress in NYC from the good folks over at Social Fresh. And so quick story about an IFTT faux pas. So I was not able to attend innovation congress in person. However, I set up IFTT to, you know, auto retweet every time Innovation Congress or Jason Keith tweeted something out. However, I'm new to IFTTT and I try and go in the recipe and I take out a lot of the Twitter jargon, the gobbledygook, so that it looks more natural. It's a bit easier to read, but I was not aware that when I did that, when it retweeted, it made it look like it was just the text, or it made it look like it was for me. And that was not my intent. I just wanted to clean it up a little bit. So anyway, on the second day of the conference, I get called out for, like, hey, can you please give credit for those tweets? Because hijacking is, you know, it's not cool. It's very unprofessional. And I tweet the person back and I'm like, hey, I'm very sorry. I didn't know that that was happening. And I go back in and I put the RT back in there. But what ends up happening is that it RT twice. So it said RT colon RT, which is that Twitter jargon I was trying to get away from and trying to make a little bit more clean. Anyway, so as the day goes on, Innovation Congress's Twitter handle blocks me, right? And I'm like, oh no, this has been a terrible misunderstanding. So I reach out to my man, Brian Fanzo, who was there at Innovation Congress. And I was like, hey, there's been a terrible mix up. I got blocked. I didn't mean to hijack. And I publicly tweet Jason Keith and Innovation Congress and say, sorry. I'm still blocked because I guess there was an intern managing whatever. But he was like, hey, don't worry about it. I talked to him. They didn't even notice. Everything's fine. But anyway, one of the things that Innovation Congress is supposed to do is help businesses focus on staying competitive in the next 3 to 5 years in the categories of digital trends, technology, innovation and societal shifts, right? So that was the theme of this year's very first Innovation Congress, helping businesses stay competitive over the next 3 to 5 years in digital trends, technology innovation, and societal shifts. And so I followed quite a few people there. Zanti Hugh, I hope I was saying that correctly. I sincerely apologize, Zanti, if I butchered your name. And over from Convince and Convert, and also follow Jillian Ryan from eMarketer. And they both commented about how diverse Innovation Congress was. And I asked them both specifically, did that apply to the audience as well? And they both said yes, which is very encouraging. However, that was not immediately apparent from the pictures that were tweeted out. When Innovation Congress very first started, you had, images being tweeted out. And in some of the sessions, there were no people of color in the audience of the sessions. You had Nick Cicero of Del Mondo leading a session. There were no people of color in the audience of his session. And later on that evening, you had a sort of a top down picture, an aerial shot, if you will, of sort of the mixer. It was happy hour. Drinks were being served. And the only people of color were serving drinks. And so this is an issue in the digital marketing conference circuit to their credit, to the folks over at Innovation Congress and Social Fresh and just the digital marketing professional speaking circuit on the whole. While they have done a very good job of trying to bring diversity in both gender and ethnicity to the speaking circuit, the audience remains very homogeneous. If you look at the audience shots of your Social Fresh, your Social Media Marketing World, your SMX, the audience shots are almost exclusively white. I mean, you're not going to see very many people of color at all. And I just want, and the reason I bring this up, and I'm trying to contrast it against what I saw at Goodie Nation's Hack the Violence Hackathon, because you had a lot of students of color there participating in tech. And I think that just goes to show you the type of diversity you can have when you have access to capital, because everybody there, all of the teams there were led by students, college students, which means that they have, student loans. And that's that access to capital to minorities that you don't see on the conference circuit. So on the conference circuit, if you're going to attend an Innovation Congress, a Social Fresh, a Social Media Marketing World, you're coming out of pocket for all of that. And that is a barrier to entry as to why, in my opinion, you don't see very many people of color in the audiences of these. I'm not talking about the stage. I'm talking about the audience shot. And in addition to the sheer cost prohibitiveness of some of these conferences, when you look on the website of a Social Media Marketing World or a Social Fresh or an SMX and you see nothing but white people, what that communicates visually to minorities and people of color is that this industry isn't for us. And nothing could be further from the truth. And given the current political climate, as I'm recording this in mid-2017, that's extremely intimidating when you have Donald Trump in the White House, because statistically speaking, half the people in the audience voted for Trump, which as a candidate, he consistently displayed a violent bent at his campaign rallies. And I'll be frank with you, Trump's campaign rallies looked like Klan rallies. They really did. And he was actively goading people on from the podium, like, yeah, get him out of there. I mean, it happened on a number of occasions. A young lady was assaulted and attacked at one of his rallies. A young man going up the steps was sucker punched by this old veteran. A Muslim woman was assaulted. And so that does not speak well to your tolerance if, that's the candidate that you went with. And this isn't a political statement. This is a statement of historical fact. That's what happened. Minorities and people of color were assaulted at Donald Trump's rallies, and he actively encouraged it. So if you supported Donald Trump, by extension, that means you support attacking people who look different than you and have different opinions. That's what that means. And so it's highly intimidating just visually looking at that as a minority, because, you know, we don't really feel safe right now. That's part of the reason for the Civility app in the first place, to report police encounters, because we don't feel safe around police. And then you want to put me in a room full of nothing but white people who may or may not support Donald Trump, who, again, historically speaking, supported violence towards minorities at his campaign rallies. It's not a good look. And if you don't support that, or if that's not what you stand for, then that needs to be reflected visually in the audience. If there are minorities in the audience, like Jillian Ryan and Zanti said, that needed to be reflected a little bit more, so it's not quite as intimidating. Because, you know, those are the fears of people when they see an audience of all white people. And it's a valid concern, because it seems like every other month, give it, you know, 90 days or so, or whatever, and you see another unarmed black person turn into a hashtag, shot dead right there on Facebook Live. And then again, historically speaking, this isn't political, these are facts. Look up the videos of what happened at his rallies when he was still a candidate and not the president. He consistently showed a violent bent toward minorities, and his supporters attacked people. So if you supported this guy, by extension, that's what you support as well. So I'm very hesitant as a black person to put myself in a room full of white folks, because I don't know which side of the fence you stay on. I don't know if you're one of those folks at the Trump rally, like, yeah, get out of here and will attack me. Or there's no way of knowing. And so that's a very big point of apprehension among a lot of minorities and black folks from a safety standpoint. So, Jason Keith, Mike Stelzner, Joe Paluzzi, I'm calling on you guys to really address this lack of diversity in your audiences and try to do something to address the access to capital, because I can assure you, not only anecdotally from my own experience, but also just participating in the hackathon, you guys have a very strong presence in the African American and minority communities. However, that does not translate into the attendance of your events because it's cost prohibitive. And I understand you guys have a business to run. I'm not asking for charity, because I don't believe black people and minorities are charities. However, there is a legitimate access issue that your conferences face that I would like you guys to take a serious stab at addressing, because again, both Jillian Ryan and Zanti said that it was a very diverse crowd. However, looking at the images, you can't really tell that from the audience. Again, I'm talking about the audience specifically. I'm not talking about the speakers. I'm talking about the people who actually attend and benefit from this information. When you look at the audience shots, very homogeneous across the board. And you can say the same thing about social media marketing world. You can say the same thing about content marketing world. The audiences are almost exclusively white, or at least that's the images that get shown on you guys' site. So I'm taking Jillian and Zanti's word for it that the audience of Innovation Congress was in fact very diverse. However, you cannot really tell that by the Twitter images that got tweeted out. You just can't, because like I said, a lot of the early shots, there were no people of color in the audiences at all. And from the top down shot, the very first night in the mixer, the only black folks or only people of color were serving drinks. And so this is an issue that I would like the organizers of these conferences to try to put their heads around how they can extend access. Even if you partner with Joey Womack of Goodie Nation Amplify for Good, right? Because obviously he has a pipeline directly into these students. Like I said, it was very diverse, very multicultural. So if I don't know what that's going to look like, because again, I know you guys have a business to run and you guys have hard costs that you have to cover. And I understand that and I get that. And I would you are all all of you conference organizers, Jason Keith, Joe Paluzzi, Mike Stelzner, again, you're all welcome on the show. And I would love to talk with you guys and maybe as best as I can connect you with Joey or whomever about addressing this access to capital issue to your event. Because again, looking at the audiences of your events, just judging by the pictures at all, frankly, it just doesn't match up with what Jillian and Zanti were saying. Both Jillian and Zanti said, oh, it was a very, very diverse audience, but you could not tell that by the pictures. And so, yeah, that's really it. That's my experience with a hackathon. Again, shout out to Joey Womack of Goodie Nation, Amplify for Good. I was blessed to be on third place Civility app, hopefully coming to an app store near you very soon. Very proud of those brothers. And, for those who are in the professional digital marketing conference circuit, look at the images of your audiences and look at the images that you portray and that you put out. Because, and I went over this in a video I did for Jason A. Miller over at LinkedIn, which I'll put in the description. Visually speaking, that does not communicate that it's industry that's open to diversity in gender as well as ethnicity. And that's something that needs to be addressed. And I'm not going to go specifically into it any more than I already have, but please do address that. And I hope you guys receive this love and criticism in the spirit of love that it was given. I'm not taking shots. I'm just giving you what I saw and what I reacted to. And yeah, I will see you guys next week.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.